Hi, I'm Marty Kelsey from the National Air and Space Museum in Washington, D.C. Today I'm at the Carolinas Aviation Museum in Charlotte, North Carolina, and I'm joined by Katie Swearingen. Thank you so much for talking with us today.
Absolutely.
Tell us the story of this plane.
So the Miracle on the Hudson aircraft, the Airbus A320 behind us, landed in the Hudson River on January 15th, 2009. It was destined for Charlotte, North Carolina, but was interrupted when a flock of geese actually flew into the aircraft, causing both engines to fail and lose thrust. So the crew had to land on the Hudson River. 155 people exited the plane, were rescued, and everyone survived. So a great story. From there, the museum, we really got lucky in getting the aircraft. Other museums were not able to house it inside. It landed right in front of the Intrepid Museum. They were in kind of the midst of getting a shuttle at the time. So we felt like this was really its home. It was destined for Charlotte. Most of the passengers were local to the area. It was business travel. So we felt like it finally made its way home to us.
Tell us about the raft here. What's its story in conjunction with the airplane?
This is not the actual raft that was used in the event, but it is exactly like the one that was used. It was donated to us by US Airways, which is now American Airlines. And we use it as an education tool with our school groups, also with adults, with really anybody that wants to climb inside of it to talk about aviation safety. So you get into the raft, we talk about what happened that day, we talk about how the passengers exited using the raft, let them put on a life vest, read their safety card, and you know, just realize that you can really play a huge role in your own safety, and that a lot of when something does go wrong, which is rare, but when it does, that you have a role to play.
And can we walk around and see some of the rest of the plane?
Sure.
All right, let's go. Katie, it looks like there's something missing here. What's going on?
There is. So we're missing a large engine. So as you know, in this event, both engines were damaged and lost thrust and were the cause of the crash. So the National Transportation and Safety Board had to do an extensive investigation with both engines, which took quite a while. And in the process of that, while the engines were very damaged during the event, they were completely disassembled by the NTSB, just looking to see what exactly happened and what were some recommendations that they can make in the future to make travel even safer. So this engine is still being reassembled by American Airline volunteers that help the museum out. And it is in the process of almost completely being restored and will eventually go on display. We do have the left engine on display. And the reason that it has taken so long, this happened in 2009, we got the aircraft in 2011, the engines have to stay with the insurance company for 3 years afterwards because of possible liabilities. So we didn't even get the engines until 2013. But it's been quite the process to put them back together because there's a lot of corrosion. We've got volunteers working to try to make it as accurate for a museum piece as possible using the original parts, but also making it safe enough to put on display.
Awesome. All right, well, let's keep walking around.
Right.
We've moved to the back of the plane. What am I seeing here?
So you're seeing some of the damage that was done in the actual landing. So when the plane landed, Sullenberger knew that he needed to land it at an 11 degree angle and straight with the wings landing flat. Otherwise, it was not going to be a very successful landing, and there would have probably been fatalities. So the back of the plane took the biggest impact, a very, very strong force. And because they had lost the thrust in both engines, he wasn't really able to control fully the speed that they were hitting. So they hit way too fast and actually ended up sliding going forward about 700 feet after they hit. So anybody sitting in the back of the aircraft had a very different experience than anyone sitting in the front of the aircraft. And actually, the flight attendant in the back, Doreen Welsh, a part of the cargo beam came up from the floor space and went into her leg, almost severing an artery. So she was one of the most severely injured during the flight. But what you're looking at is some of that damage, and this piece actually was still attached, so it would have been hanging down. And this is also where you'll find the APU, the auxiliary power unit, which Sullenberger did flip on to have a little bit more energy for those engines.
Okay. And you talked about the flight attendant being injured. She kept doing her job, didn't she?
Oh, yes, she did. Doreen is very honest when she talks about this event. She knew that when Sullenberger said, brace for impact, she knew they were crashing, and she thought that she was going to die. But she also, her training just kicked in, and she was, you know, telling the passengers to get down and to brace. And then the second they hit, she's checking the doors. She sees that there's water. So the water's already flooding in. She, by the time that she got out, said, you know, says it up to her neck. But she's telling the passengers to go forward. They've got to go out at the wings. They've got to go out at the front. So she continued to do her job till the very end.
And saved a whole lot of people that day.
She did.
We've moved over in front of the engine, and this engine actually came off the plane, correct?
It did. So this engine was actually in the Hudson River for 8 days before it was recovered.
Now tell me what we're seeing here.
So the cool thing about this engine is that they were able to put it together. It's 95% original. So they only used parts to provide stability in areas that are not visible. So everything that you see that is visible is original to the engine. You can definitely notice the corrosion from the Hudson River, which, you know, we'll be battling as to trying to preserve it for the lifetime of this engine. Some interesting things to point out are how the fan blades are really, they're pushed back because when the plane hit the water, the impact of the water coming into the blades actually pushed those titanium fan blades back. You also notice the numbering on the fan blades. That's from the NTSB investigation. As we talked about with the other engines, these were completely disassembled and had to be put back together by American Airlines volunteers.
Do they know how many geese they hit that day?
They do. So two geese went into each engine, and they actually know that it was three males and one female. And they know that because of Carla Dove, who is a forensic ornithologist who works for the Smithsonian. And she did the investigation for this accident and found, she studied the bird remains.
And there's a word for
that. And there is a word for that. It is called snarch. So she spends her days studying snarch.
From here, you can also see that there's some damage here at the front of the plane, but that wasn't caused by the landing.
Right. So we really try to encompass and tell an entire story of this event. From when the geese hit, from when they landed in the water, from the rescue efforts, and also from the recovery, and then its travels to the museum. So we generally like to say below the red line on the aircraft is mostly from the emergency landing. A lot that you see above that is really from the rescue, from the ferry boats hitting it. A lot of the dents that you'll see in the plane are from those rescue boats actually bumping into the plane. Sullenberger is very clear to point out that the cockpit windows were not damaged when they landed, and we point that out as well on our Take a Closer Look panels, that they were probably, we're not totally sure, but probably hit by a ferry boat. Also, the crane that pulled the plane out of the water did some damage as well, and then of course the investigation. They took the wings off, actually sawed them off, so they're not really reattached to the plane. They're about this far off.
But amazingly, for a plane that landed in the middle of a river, it's really intact.
It's very intact. It's in wonderful condition, and if you go inside the interior of the aircraft, it basically looks like any passenger aircraft that you would get in. A couple of things are askew, and there's definitely some silt from the Hudson River. But other than that, it looks pretty good.
Wow. Well, thank you so much for showing us around today.